At the dawn of the Second World War, air power fundamentally redefined the battlefield, with ground attack aircraft delivering crippling strikes against ground forces. To counter this emerging and formidable threat, the U.S. military sought to develop a mobile anti-aircraft vehicle capable of effectively defending its troops. This initiative led to the creation of the M13 and M14 multiple gun motor carriages, pioneering designs that would lay the groundwork for a series of increasingly potent anti-aircraft halftracks. The swift German invasions of Poland, France, and the Low Countries made heavy use of close air support, inflicting significant casualties on the defending ground forces. These tactics did not go unnoticed by neutral observers, particularly the United States. Alarmed by the effectiveness of Germany's Luftwaffe, the U.S. Army High Command moved quickly to develop a viable self-propelled anti-aircraft gun. The earliest attempt began in October 1940 with the T-1 multiple gun motor carriage, a half-ton Dodge VC-4 truck fitted with a powered twin 50-caliber M2 machine gun turret developed by Bendix Aviation Corporation. However, tests conducted at Aberdeen Proving Ground in June and July 1942 revealed critical flaws. Excessive shot dispersion and insufficient space for ammunition severely hampered its battlefield viability. To improve stability and capacity, engineers turned to the M2 halftrack as a new platform. On July 17, 1941, the turret was mounted onto its chassis, and the vehicle was redesignated T1E1. Unfortunately, the Bendix turret continued to disappoint. Its mechanical complexity and lack of durability led to the Army to deem it unsuitable for combat. Nevertheless, the concept of a mobile, half-track-based anti-aircraft platform had taken root, laying the foundation for more successful designs to follow. In November 1941, the W.L. Maxon Corporation presented a new design for a compact, powered turret mounting two 12.7mm M2 Browning machine guns. On 27th of November, authorization was granted to install this turret onto an M2 halftrack, creating the multiple gun motor carriage T1E2. By early 1942, a prototype turret was completed and tested at Aberdeen Proving Ground. The trials demonstrated that the Maxon turret was significantly simpler, more rugged, and more accurate than competing designs. As a result, in March 1942, the Ordnance Department officially standardized the turret as the Twin Caliber 50 Machine Gun Mount M33. Initial testing of the M33 mount on the M2 halftrack showed promising stability while firing, but it was quickly determined that the M3 halftrack might prove even better for the role due to having additional space for crew and improved ammunition storage. The combination of the M3 chassis and M33 turret was designated Multiple Gun Motor Carriage T1E4. In April 1942, a T1E4 prototype was built and tested at Aberdeen. These tests led to the T1E4's standardization as the Multiple Gun Motor Carriage M13 in September 1942. The first production M13 vehicles arrived at Aberdeen for evaluation in December 1942, when the M33 mount was found to be highly satisfactory. Mass production of the M13 began in January 1943 at the White Motor Company. Between January and May 1943, a total of 1,103 vehicles were produced. Of these, the first 535 were retained as M13s, while the remaining units were upgraded to the M16 multiple gun motor carriage prior to being shipped. After the introduction of the M13 into service, it was determined that a similar vehicle would also be developed for Allied nations, prompting an initiative to develop a compatible variant using the M5 half-track chassis, which was already being produced for lend-lease purposes. Representatives from International Harvester visited Cleveland to examine the T1E4 prototype and assess its adaptability to the M5 chassis. The resulting vehicle was designated the Multiple Gun Motor Carriage M14, Testing of the M14 at Aberdeen Proving Ground between February and May 1943 revealed that it performed on par with or better than the M13, with notably easier steering. However, the tests also identified shortcomings. The rear suspension was weak, and both the fuel pump and engine starter were less accessible. In response to promising results, the Chicago Ordnance District requested the International Harvester submit a proposal to produce 12,711 M14 vehicles. A formal production order was issued on 6 October 1942, with the Ordnance Department hoping productions could begin in November 1942. However, material shortages delayed the start until December 1942. The production target was soon revised. In January 1943, the order was reduced to 11,909 vehicles, with the remainder redirected towards the production of mortar carriers. On 2nd of March 1943, the contract was further reduced to just 2,800 units, eliminating the mortar carrier requirement entirely. Following further negotiations, the final number of M14s was set at 1,605 vehicles, with the balance of the contract amended to produce 1,000 M17 multiple gun motor carriages. Production of the M14 began in December 1942 and continued until December 1943, with a total of 1,605 units built by International Harvester. The basic design of the M13 and M14 multiple gun motor carriages closely mirrored that of the M3 and M5 halftracks, respectively. Their layout remained largely unchanged. The cab and engine compartment were retained as is, while the passenger area was stripped out to accommodate the gun turret and ammunition storage chests. The vehicles retained the original rolled face hardened steel armor, bolted together in the same fashion as their base models. However, the rear access door was removed, and the upper portion of the rear compartment was designed to fold down. The M13 MGMC was powered by a 147 white 160AX, a four-cycle inline-cylinder, liquid-cooled gasoline engine. It had a combat weight of 8,391.5 kilograms, yielding a power-to-weight ratio of 15.9 horsepower per ton. The vehicle measured 6.5 meters long, 2 meters wide, and 2.2 meters tall. Its armor consisted of 6.5mm plate throughout, except for the windshield cover, which was 12.7mm thick. The M14 MGMC, in contrast, used a 143 horsepower International Harvester RED 450B, also a gasoline-powered, liquid-cooled engine. Its combat weight was slightly higher at 8,709 kilograms, resulting in a power-to-rate ratio of 14.9 horsepower per ton. The M14 was slightly larger than the M13, measuring 6.5 meters long, 2.2 meters wide, and 2.3 meters tall. Like the M13, the M14's windshield armor was 12.7 millimeters thick, while the rest of the armor was 6.5 millimeters. The M13 and M14 multiple gun motor carriages featured a semi-elliptical, longitudinal leaf spring front suspension paired with shock absorbers and steel ventilated disc brakes. Their rear suspension utilized a bogey system with spring-loaded idler wheels and 18 tooth-driven sprockets. Each bogey incorporated vertical volute springs and supported 8 paired road wheels. Both vehicles used Kegress-style rubber tracks, consisting primarily of a single continuous rubber band with a width of 304.8 millimeters. The M13 and M14 were capable of overcoming obstacles up to 304.8 millimeters high, scaling slopes of up to a 60-degree grade and fording water up to 81.3 centimeters deep. The M13 had a turning diameter of 18.3 meters, while the M14 could turn within 18 meters. Armament-wise, both vehicles employed the M33 gun mount, which carried two M2HB 12.7mm machine guns, with a total of 5,000 rounds of ammunition on board. The mount could traverse 360 degrees at a rate of approximately 74 degrees per second and elevate from minus 11.5 to 90 degrees at 72 degrees per second. The gunner sat centrally in the turret, protected by a frontal armored shield, and aimed using either an M18 reflex sight or an illuminated Mark 9 Mod 1 sight, both powered by an onboard battery or gasoline generator. The gunner controlled turret movement with dual control handles. Twisting the handles forward or backward adjusted gun elevation, while rotating them directed traverse with a turret speed proportional to handle movement. Each gun was fed from a 200-round ammunition chest, which could be reloaded in under 2 minutes by swapping chests. The M2HBs had a cyclic rate of fire of 450 to 575 rounds per minute, with a muzzle velocity of 873.3 meters a second and a maximum effective range of 5.49 kilometers when firing M1 tracer rounds. The M13 and M14 multiple gun motor carriages were operated by a 5-man crew. The driver, positioned on the left side of the cab, the commander, seated to the right, the gunner, located in the turret mount, and two cannoneers, who were stationed on either side of the gun mount or seated just in front of it. To coordinate effectively, the crew utilized SCR-510 or SCR-528 radios, as well as the M238 flag set for visual signaling. Provisions for personal weapons were included in the vehicle loadout. These consisted of one M1928A1 Thompson submachine gun with 420 rounds of 11.43mm ammunition, one M1903 Springfield rifle equipped with a rifle grenade adapter along with 10 M9A1 rifle grenades, three M1 carbines chambered in 7.62mm, 26 hand grenades including 12 Mark 11 fragmentation grenades, 12 M8 smoke grenades, and two incendiary grenades. The M13 MGMC was used primarily for training purposes. Only 139 units were deployed, and these first saw combat during the invasion of Italy in 1943. They later took part in the invasion of southern France, but by April 1944, they were being replaced by the more powerful M16. In January 1945, the M13 was declared obsolete, and by February 1945, it is believed that few, if any, remained in operational service. The U.S. Army soon determined that its anti-aircraft vehicles required greater firepower, which led to the development of the M45 mount. This was a modified version of the M33, designed to carry four M2 12.7mm machine guns instead of two. The mount was first tested on the M13 chassis, leading to the creation of the M16 MGMC, and was also installed on the M14 chassis, resulting in the M17 MGMC. These upgraded vehicles and their operational history will be covered in a future video. So, make sure to subscribe and stay tuned to catch that episode when it drops. The United Kingdom received 10 M13s and approximately 1,600 M14s throughout the Lend-Lease program, intended for use by Commonwealth forces. However, these vehicles were modified for a different role. The original M33 gun mounts, ammunition storage, personal weapon racks, and sections of the flooring were removed to convert the vehicles into armored personnel carriers. In their place, wooden benches were installed along the front and sides of the troop compartment to accommodate infantry. Under the terms of the Lend-Lease Agreement, Britain was obligated to either return the equipment to the United States or to pay for it. A third, more pragmatic option was eventually adopted, transferring surplus vehicles to Belgium and the Netherlands for scrapping. This arrangement, however, offered an unexpected opportunity to rebuilding armies looking for cheap surplus hardware, often acquired at the mere cost of scrap metal. Among the major beneficiaries was Argentina, although both Belgium and the Netherlands themselves also incorporated these vehicles into service. Reports also suggest that smugglers took advantage of the situation, stealing vehicles from scrap depots to use as transports and to evade checkpoints. In the 1950s, Spain acquired between 50 and 78 M14 APCs, presumably purchased directly from the United States, though it's possible that they originated from the Belgian or Dutch surplus stockpiles. In 1957, 11 M14s were deployed to the Spanish Sahara with cavalry units to support operations during the Ifni War. These M14s remained in service until their retirement between 1965 and 1974, when they were replaced by the more modern M113 armored personnel carriers. Meanwhile, a number of M14s marked for scrapping were acquired by the Israeli Defense Force by late 1948, likely sourced from surplus vehicle dumps in Hounslow and Newcastle, UK. In Israeli service, these M14s were employed primarily as APCs, though many were subsequently heavily modified with various weapons systems. And that's it for this video. Other, more advanced halftracks will be covered in a future video, and in the meantime, let us know what you think of this one. Were the Brits right to convert them into APCs while waiting for more potent designs? Were two machine guns potent enough as the anti-aircraft armament for 1943? Let us know in the comments below. As always, we invite you to subscribe to stay updated on future content. If you'd like to contribute further, consider supporting us on Patreon or PayPal. We want to especially thank our medium and heavy tank Patreon supporters: Dave Schuford, Softwift21, Wolfhund, Barrett Gunthor, Dan Fitzpatrick, Owen M., R. Rob, Leslie Hulkauer, and Michael Herman. Your generous contributions help fund our research, illustrations, and video production. Until next time, keep us in your sights!